Today, my name is Craig Blanchette, and I'm a health coach, and I've been health coaching for now, I don't know, it's been about 7 or 8 years, and it's my pleasure really to bring this health talks. We've got a great lineup today. We've got 4 speakers, and we've got some people that are going to share their stories with us today. And really what I'm hoping that you'll do is kind of sit back and just kind of take it in. We've got some interesting topics that'll hopefully inspire you. Maybe that'll awaken something in you. And I'm hoping at the end, you'll possibly say, man, I want more of that. Maybe you say, I'm not as healthy as I want to be. Let's do this, right? We're all looking to have more yes days when we wake up in the morning and we have something that we want to do. If we've taken care of them, our bodies will say, yes, let's go do that. And sometimes if we haven't, our body says, maybe tomorrow. And so we're all looking for more yes days. So I'm going to give just a little intro here as we give an overview of what we're going to be talking about today. Let me share my screen with you. And let's see here. There we go. So we're going to start off each speaker. We have 4 different speakers, and we're going to be covering one of these particular 4 topics. So we've got coaching, we've got habits, we've got community, and we've got fueling. And what we've done is we take those 4 cornerstones, and then we build pillars, if you will. And each one of those areas has habits or actions that you can take that build upon that cornerstone. And then we have a roof at the top, and we call that the trilogy of optimal health. It's a kind of a capstone. And that really is living in a healthy body, having a healthy mind, and then having healthy finances or a career vocation. And so we build the support network for that the trilogy of optimal health at the top there by the things that are below it. So that's kind of a little idea there that hopefully resonates with you and will give you some context for the speakers that we have that are going to be sharing their stories with you shortly. And so first up, we have Alex McMillan. I've been working with Alex McMillan now for about 5 years, and he's been helping so many people, myself included, with the journey towards having healthier tomorrows than we did yesterday. So it's my privilege to bring on Alex McMillan. Welcome, Alex.
Hey, Craig. Can you hear me all right?
Yep, loud and clear.
Man, I'm excited to be on. Thank you so much for allowing me to be a guest on this amazing Health Talks. And for all of you out there, I'm so glad you gave yourself this space today, this time to actually be here with us. If you think about this, it's very powerful what you decided to do. You could be anywhere you want to be right now, anywhere in the world. You know, I'm sure you could go rack up a credit card bill and fly to Greece. Maybe you have it sitting in your bank account. I don't know. And escape life. But you actually chose to be here on Health Talks and to plug in with all of us. And you know what? I'm at one of the happiest and whiniest places on earth. I'm at Disneyland. I'm not sure if you can actually see my shirt. My internet's coming through with my kids. It's an amazing place. The people here are all fired up at the same time. Come 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night. Oh my goodness. Craziness. Well, Craig, you know, I'm sitting here in a workout room in my hotel, and this place has all these affirmations, and these affirmations on the wall are just amazing. And one of the words is, it says, every day is a good day to work out. And I believe every day is a good day to come on a health talks like this and really set some habits into your life. And I want to talk to you today about what a habit is, how you form it, and how it's going to literally create the life that you want. Let me start by this statement, which is powerful. You know, it goes like this. First, you create your habits. Then your habits create you. Think about that for a minute. If we don't pick our habits and decide what those habits we want in our life are going to be, you're going to find your life becoming something and looking like something you don't want. Did you know this? That about 40 to 50% of every single thing you do in a day is driven by the habits that are automatically set in your life and in your mind by how you programmed yourself before. The choices and things you made yesterday, they definitely influence what you do today. And in fact, I'm going to go beyond that and show you something that's just going to shock you. 90-some-odd percent of what you think about in your mind is programmed by your subconscious mind of what you've programmed in. And the habits, that's crazy. 90-something percent of what you think about is there. So when you think about creating a life of health, of wealth, and of amazing relationships, that's only going to happen if the thoughts that you have to pull from and the habits that you've created in your life are there to help that happen. Blessing is this, that from this moment right here, moving forward, you can make the decision to create habits of health in your life that are going to drive the majority of the choices. How would that feel for you to know that you don't have to use willpower of like, oh, I've got to try and stick with this good eating choice, or I've got to try and fit this exercise in and figure out and get up the tenacity to do that? How good would that feel to know that the words that come out of your mouth around that significant other or the other people you work with are just blessings and lifting and create value? And all of a sudden, there's this reciprocity coming back to you where just it's like you've heard this word, the law of attraction. Well, the law of attraction is about what radio station or what frequency you're putting out there. And so if you've basically created a habit that is healthy, and I'm going to tell you about that, you're going to start to see that that's going to bring good things in, since you know this. If you go down the wrong path on the way to work, where are you going to end up? Not at work. If you go down the wrong path on the way to Disneyland, where are you going to end up? Not at Disneyland. You go down the wrong path with your eating choices, with your financial choices, with your exercise choices, with the communications, where are you going to end up? Not at the health, the wealth, and the relationship that you want. You see, habit is a pathway. And this is amazing. And what we're going to talk about here in the next 5 minutes is exactly how you're going to be able to identify that path, get on it, and stay on it. And if for some reason you find yourself wandering off, you're going to know how to see that very clearly in your mind and jump back on it. All right, fair enough? So look at this for a moment. Think of a good habit as that path you routinely take that makes your life gooder, just kidding, better or improved the way you want. Think of a good habit as something that moves you closer or directly to your true desires and goals. I'm talking about the true, true desires and goals. And these habits have the power and the ability to keep you in that good place that you desire and to maintain that, because they'll become automatic. It's like orbiting around the earth, and all of a sudden it's just so effortless as you're out there in weightlessness. But creating that habit takes a little energy, just like getting off the earth in that rocket ship. There's a lot of energy in the beginning, but it's worth it. So you're going to need a little bit of support and structure. I want you to picture this rocket ship getting ready to get out in this outer space where it's almost effortless and weightless out there and able to do things. And you know, you can jump and then jump 200, 300 feet up, or maybe infinitely without a whole lot of effort. But getting up into that place takes some structure and some focus, like Craig was showing that house before. And we're going to talk about how you're going to get that. Now, so that was a good habit. It's a path that routinely takes you to a better place that you desire and helps you to maintain that state. Now, I want you to picture it in your mind's eye what a bad habit is. A bad habit is almost exactly the same, one little caveat different. To put, it's a routine that takes you somewhere that temporarily feels good and feels like it makes your life better, but just for a moment. But ultimately, it moves you further away from your true desires and the way you want to feel. And it's sneaky, because in the beginning, it doesn't it feel like that thing that is a bad habit that you have, it gives you some instant gratification? I'll give you a couple examples. Walking down, all of a sudden there's some cookies sitting there, and I just, before I know it, I've got three of them in my mouth. What's up with that? How did that happen? Like, who is this? Whose hand is this, right? Ever had one of those moments? Or here, I have some of this. your significant other says something to you, and before you know it, you've barked out three or four words that were demeaning and crushing in the relationship. Well, whose mouth was this? Who's controlling that? Right? And it's all of a sudden, it's like something's taken over you. It's not you. Have you ever had that happen before? Or you had the intention to get that exercise in, or the intention to start that IRA fund, or the intention to, but for some reason, you got the paycheck and you decided to go spend it on, and you decided to not put it here, but get something else that gave you some instant gratification. That's how powerful your habits can be. They can take over. It's almost like they possess you. And so this is going to kind of, again, another freaky, shocking little bit of information for you. Your habits are either going to bring you, like I said before, the health and the wealth and the happiness because you've created this routine. That's a blessing to your life. Or they're going to be a curse, and they're going to add dis-ease, make life more uncomfortable. That dis-ease brings disease, which ultimately leads to destruction. All right. So this word habit comes from a Latin word, which is off of another word, which means to habitat or inhabit. Now, if you think about this for a moment, this word habitat, what does that mean? It's like where you dwell. It's the space that you're in, right? So habits inhabit you. That's very interesting. They're actually something that like possess, and that's why you could be walking past that plate of cookies, have the best of intention to do well. That's why you could have this health goal in your life and go out with friends, and before you know it, you got a drink in your hand and a bunch of unhealthy foods that are giving you instant gratification, but ultimately you feel guilty. So would you like to know how to be the master over those habits? Now, I will tell you the secret to this is going to be having someone who can coach and guide you there, having support and community who can help reinforce that, and having the right choices to be able to make. So wait till you hear what's coming up on the rest of today's health talks, because it's going to lock this sucker in. But you want to, this talk is just to help give you the understanding of how to you create these things that are going to inhabit you. Wouldn't you like to choose which thoughts are going to inhabit your mind, which automatic actions that you take, so that the fueling of the way you feed yourself and the choices that you make in the way you project out in those relationships and how your income is generated and created build because the habits drive that? Would you want that? So think about this for a moment. The question is, do you possess your habits or are they possessing you? Which do you prefer? Because somebody's going to get owned. I'm telling you what, right? Better be you. Why don't you own them? Step up and say, I choose to be the boss. I choose to decide what's going on. So here's why habits are important. Because they help you not have to think so much. Who would like to have to think less, get healthy, get wealthy, and have more joyful relationships? Yeah, no, for real. Yeah, I'm raising my hand on that. I hope the rest of you hundreds of people watching this are raising your hand. Think about it. Would you like to just to have this think less and have it happen? Well, that's what a habit does for you. This is a loop that's created in your brain. It's like pushing the one button on your computer and a whole orchestration of commands take place and all these automatic features. You know, there's like 60 trillion cellular connections going on in your body right now, keeping you alive every second, like 60 trillion things are happening every second in you. Aren't you glad that that's automatic? You don't have to think about that. So you have about 80,000 thoughts that can go through your mind in a day. That's crazy. Not that many consciously, but subconsciously, about 80,000 things are influencing you. That's why you want to have habits that are going to become automatic to drive you. So they ultimately help you conserve energy. Habits ultimately help you conserve energy so that you can flow in your day and get the results that you want and get the kind of outcomes that you want. So we have a system called the habits of health. And health is your healthy body, your healthy mind, and your healthy finances. So don't think about health as just being your food choices. Think about it as, I've got a relationship that thrives. My finances is thriving. And would you rather build that health on the sand? where when the winds blow and the waves come up and the rain beats down, that house gets washed away? Or would you rather have that habit built and that house built on a rock, that when all that adversity comes, you stand? See, these habits, when you pick one and you say, I want to create the habit of healthy eating, that is worth digging down and finding the bedrock of why you want that, and then getting the right kind of support to help you build that and found that down. And the system that we use to create that, which is so nice, this is so simple to do, actually allows you to know how to lay that down and how to move that forward. See, you have a routine that happens. When it comes to, I'm just going to pick one of these areas, when it comes to making a healthy food choice and it comes to making the right decision, what happens is you're looking for some kind of reward of gratification and satisfaction. And what if you could get that gratification and feeling of fulfillment and satisfaction without doing something that would be detrimental to your health? So when all of a sudden you see that cookie, what if it could be this, that you see that cookie as, here's a choice that I get to make. The cookie now means consider. The cookie now means I get to actually decide who's in the ownership and who's in the driver's seat. Do these habits own me, or do I get to own these habits? What if you could be reprogrammed in this way to where all of a sudden you're on a solid rock and you're able to say, I know why I'm going to choose to consider the choice that I want. Take a deep breath. And I'm going to create a new routine. You may even choose to let the cookies be there and to pull out your health food that you have for yourself. You may choose to actually stop and go, am I actually hungry? Or is it that that's just a habit? Awareness. I see it. The cookies now all of a sudden can mean I'm going to be aware. I'm going to be considerate of myself. I'm going to have compassion on what I really want. And I'm going to choose me and my health, the one that I want to create. See, that's powerful. Or you could create a new routine. That's a new routine. Wouldn't that be? Or you can create a new routine and say, I'm going to choose not to go the path of those cookies. Since Barbara's got those cookies always sitting there on the nurse's desk, or Bob's always got those donuts sitting over there, or those M&Ms in that jar, I'm going to choose to create a new loop. And when I take that new loop down the office path or however you walk, I'm going to think about this as that I chose this. All right, there's a lot of little nuances, but they're simple to create in your life once you understand how this works. Very, very powerful. So that basically is what we call, you have a cue, something that kind of triggers this process. Maybe you come home from work and you're feeling tired, and your natural thing is, I want a reward of feeling de-stressed, right? So you would choose to go in and get that with food. And maybe you already ate right before you got home. Maybe you haven't. Regardless, you're going to create a new routine in between the cue of where the M&Ms were, where the donuts were, or just coming home from work, if you will, and the reward that you're looking for, which is the satisfaction. The habits of health system that we talk about and create and talk about, and Craig's going to get into coaching and how, or someone's going to get into coaching. I think it's you, Craig. I'm not sure. Is it you? About how important, are you shaking? I can't see you just for a second here.
No, it's going to be Bill. Bio. Yep.
All right, Bill. Oh my goodness. Boy, you guys are in for a treat. Craig's going to be a treat on his topic, but Bill's going to nail this. I know it. So wait till you hear how simple it is to be able to move from where you are to where you want to be when you get the right coaching and support there. All right. So as we're talking about this, now you understand that you're the boss. These habits, you're going to choose to possess them and not have them possess you. You're going to create a new routine, and you're going to get the coaching you need so that that's simple. And you're going to use a system so that this can be automatic. Not all, I have to think about all this stuff. Again, how many of you raised your hand that it would be so nice to be able to get through a good day in a healthy way, better finances, better relationships that are not governed and controlled by all of this thoughts that are taking me over. All right. Second thing is this. You want to launch these habits appropriately. And when I say launch these habits, what I mean is get them started and get them going so that they can start controlling the rest of your day. Well, I'll tell you what. If you're getting up, I'm going to give you, this is my favorite number one habit in the world. If you're getting up and rushing right into your day and your day is controlling you and owning you, and you're bouncing from one thing, I call it pinballing, one thing to the next, you're already in the habit loop that's already been established. There's no room for choice because the habits are too powerful. You're going to be bouncing and reacting to everything that's going on. But if you want to be the boss, the person who responds to life and acts on it, get yourself up a little earlier than you've been getting up. Create the habit of giving yourself a buffer and a little space to decide what you want life to look like this day. Get the support that you need to create a morning routine for you that's going to give you the kind of start, because how you start definitely influences how you're going to finish. I'll tell you what, it's been a blessing to be on this with you. I can't wait for you to get the rest of what's going to be talking about today in the community and in the coaching and in the fuelings. Absolutely a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me again, Craig.
Yeah, thanks, Alex. Enjoy. It's a wonderful time to be with family, obviously.
Disneyland, yep.
So enjoy the rest of
your
family. Thanks for sharing a little bit of insights you had. Really just about setting up those habits. And so go enjoy the habit of family and fun and screaming and all that, right? Thanks
we'll
again,
do
Alex.
It, man. You got it.
Yep. So, yeah, so today I'm going to be talking a little bit. I'm up next. And before I actually get into my topic, though, I wanted to have you guys take a second and jump over to the chat and type in the chat where you're from. And I don't know, mostly where you're from and maybe one thing that you're working on as far as your health goes. So let's light up that chat window and see where everyone's from here. And I'm going to get set up. I'm going to be talking about the idea of fueling our bodies. The food that we, you've heard the term, you are what you eat. And so the stuff that we put in our mouths actually becomes who we are. And if we put good stuff in, we become good stuff. And if we put in junk stuff, we kind of become and start to feel junky. So I'm going to be going into that here in just a second. But I also wanted to say, so a lot of people, New Jersey, wow, healthy sleep, great stuff. Happy Valley, Oregon, another person from New Jersey. Wow, people from all around the country. That's great. By the way, if you have folks, we are going broadcasting live on Facebook. If you're a Facebook friend of mine, you'll be seeing this on live. So I want to say hello to all of you that are joining us right now on Facebook Live. And lastly, we do have a Q&A functionality. And so we've got some folks that are standing by to answer your questions today. And so on your Zoom console, you can click Q&A, and then you can ask questions if you have something that you wanted to ask. But welcome, everybody that's joining us on this Saturday morning, or maybe late morning if you're on the East Coast. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about fueling our bodies. It's one of the second pillars in the in that house that I talked about at the beginning. But I want to start off with sharing just a little bit about my background. I'm a professional wheelchair racer. I've been racing wheelchairs and hand cycles and had a pretty active lifestyle since I was, 16, 17. And so you can see in the top two pictures, actually funny kind of story, that top left picture with me with those cool sunglasses and that hat on, I was at Disney World. And I put on that tank top that day and I thought, I'm going to be showing off my big, it's a gun show and I'm going to get a little sun and all that. And I looked back at that later when we got the photo and my wife saw it and she goes, can you burn that tank top? And I thought, yes, I can. Never going to wear that again. It just wasn't very flattering. And ultimately, I just wasn't in really good shape. I'd kind of let myself go and life kind of started happening. The picture on the bottom left there, I was at a friend of mine's wedding and I was at my heaviest, about 175 pounds. For those of you who may or may not know me, I'm only 3'9", so I'm a pretty short guy. And so 175 pounds on a 3'9" frame was kind of pudgy. But you can see in the middle picture and the two pictures on the right, that's after I discovered how to implement these four cornerstones in my life, working with a coach, working with a fueling plan, working, connecting with a healthier community, and then learning these habits of health like Alex just talked about. And so lost that 50 pounds, was able to go back and do some competing again at a super high level. And it's just been great. And so anyway, I got a little pop quiz I want to throw up here. And this is going to be a little quiz on what glycemic index is. I've been thinking about being healthy and doing all those things for a while, but I really didn't understand the connection between glycemic index and health, and how the things that we eat end up affecting our blood sugar. And when we raise our blood sugar quickly, what does that do? We're going to be talking about that a little bit today. But go ahead and jump over onto your computers, and there should be a poll that's up in front of you. And go ahead and click on, you know, the first question is, which is healthier based on glycemic index? Is it blackberries or blueberries? So which has more glucose, essentially? By the way, I'm going to talk about this a little bit later, but the glycemic index goes from 0 to 100. And a food that, pure glucose, pure sugar is 100. And so it's somewhere between 0 and 100. And then the second question is kiwi or an orange? Which one is lower on the glycemic index? And the third one, we have cherries or grapes. What do you guys think? And the last one is bananas or apples, right? Don't those always go together, bananas and apples? Come on. And so go ahead and cast your votes, which one you think is there. Because here's the thing that I found. If what I think is healthy turns out not to be, then no matter how much I do that particular thing, I'm never going to get the result I want, which is to be healthier. And it's interesting. The blackberries and blueberries, it's about 50-50 right now. Blueberries are winning at 56 and blackberries are losing at 44, right? Anybody else, if you want to vote, go ahead. We've got about half of the people that have voted, about 62%. So go ahead and cast your vote. Just give it your best guess. All right, we'll save about another 10 seconds. Go ahead and quickly cast your vote, folks. And I'm going to go through the answers and tell you what is actually true. And hopefully you'll go, whoa, now I know. It doesn't mean you should never, ever eat something. You know, like eat something that's high glycemic. It doesn't mean you can't eat it. But what it will mean is you can't eat it and expect your blood sugar not to raise quickly and the effects that that has on your body. So blackberries and blueberries, man, they're duking it out. Kiwis are winning over an orange. Cherries are slaughtering grapes. That's good. And apples are killing bananas. All right, so here's the results. Here's the results from the poll, so you guys can see which one won. And then we're actually going to go into showing you exactly what the answer is there. So. Thanks for taking the poll with us today. And so glycemic index, we talked about this. 0 to 30 is considered low GI. And so it's not going to raise your blood sugar in a dramatic way. 30 to 50 is low to mid GI. And having those types of foods more sparingly, but definitely you can have those. And then if it's above 50 to 100, you want to use some caution there. You want to think about, this is going to raise my blood sugar, which is going to cause me some challenges. So here's the list. We got to get this out of the Dr. A's Habits of Health book. And so if you think about it, look at those cherries, 25. So those of you that, and look at those blackberries, 25. So those of you that voted for blackberries or cherries, well done, right? Apples are a 30, still doing great. Oranges at a 35. Good job. For those of you that picked bananas, blueberries, kiwi, grapes, cantaloupe, all of those are above 50 and will raise your blood sugar, which will cause your body to produce extra insulin. And then what happens is your blood sugar crashes, and low blood sugar means high hunger. Some of you have probably heard the term, I've got a sweet tooth. Maybe you've said that before. Well, the sweet tooth is basically somebody that has heavy blood sugar fluctuations where it goes up and down, up and down. And when your blood sugar's low, all of a sudden you got a sweet tooth. I've got so many people that when they understand how to eat and how to fuel their body in a way that controls their blood sugar, magically they've gone to the dentist and they've removed the sweet tooth, right? And it's not really what happened, but we just actually they're controlling their blood sugar better now. So here's the question for you. What is your typical day? For most people that are struggling with weight issues, struggling with blood sugar issues, struggling really just with health, you know, they get home and they're kind of burnt out. They start their day and it looks like this. Anybody want to comment on that? If that's you, put that's me or a yes in the chat window, right? When first thing in the morning, is this breakfast? Is this the breakfast of champions? Vitamin C in the morning, standing for coffee. A lot of people will wake, the thing they do is they go get their coffee and they're off to work. And that coffee gives you a little bit of a boost, probably some calories, and also gives you some caffeine. And so it can kind of get your energy up a little bit. And then we're going to, you're off with the day. Sometime around noon, maybe 1 o'clock, your body puts you in a headlock and says, you feed me or I'm going to hurt you. Maybe you'll have another cup of coffee. I don't know. Maybe you'll grab some snacks around the office. And then you starve yourself and just kind of cruise along until you get home in the evening. And then you got no work to do and you're not busy or distracted. And so you have that big meal, right? Lots of people do that. That's a pretty common thing. Here's another scenario is sometimes we'll wake up and sorry to, if this disturbs you, but orange juice is pretty much sugar in liquid form, right? Just got, you know, it's natural, but you have that blood sugar that goes way up and then it drops up and down, up and down. And so you can see that's a normal thing. This is a person that's very hungry. This is a person with a sweet tooth. And what we try to, our strategy is to have lower glycemic foods and fuel that don't raise our blood sugar drastically and keep it more down around the baseline. This is a much different feel. This person doesn't have a sweet tooth, right? This person has consistent energy throughout the day. So here's one of my strategies that I use. I think of these three ideals. I think I want to have food that's healthy, but usually if you're healthy, it's not tasty, right? Or if it's tasty, or maybe if it's healthy or if it's tasty, it's not easy. It's a lot of steps. But I want to find foods that are healthy, tasty, and easy. Because they're not easy, eventually I'm going to quit. A lot of people do these programs where they have a lot of food prep. And they can do it for a little while. Man, they just get worn out. Then they go back to easy. So that's the sweet spot. Healthy, tasty, you can have both, and easy. You can have all three of those. Got to do a little bit of homework, but you can have all three of those. Here's a picture of me back in 1988. Whew, 18 years old. Hallelujah. Look at that. Believe it or not, underneath that hood, I had all this hair. I don't know what I was thinking, covering all that hair when I could grow it. I should have been showing it, right? But this is me at the 1988 Olympic Games. And I won a bronze medal there. I went out to the front, pulled hard, had an awesome race. Ended up getting nipped at the end by 0.6 seconds between, it was 0.9 seconds between first and third. So those are two guys, Mustafa Badid from France and Paul Van Winkle from Belgium. And so what I want to tell you is a little strategy that I use that I've been using for 25 years, 30 years. And it's my running fuel, pre-race dinner fuel, right? And so a lot of times people, you need a carb load. You need to have this big pasta feed and all this kind of stuff. Well, pasta is a pretty starchy vegetable, or not vegetable, food. And so it raises your blood sugar pretty quickly. And some it'll store some blood sugar, in your liver. But what I've used for years is a yam. And a yam has a much slower burn, and it's a glycemic index of 35. Depends on how you cook it. boiled yams are between 35 and 44. And so it's not going to spike your blood sugar, which is not going to have that insulin thing. And this has a nice slow burning. So think about this in the future. If any of you guys are doing any athletic competition, the night before, you might consider maybe microwaving or boiling a yam and then having some type of a protein with it. Sometimes I'll do egg whites. Sometimes I'll do a piece of chicken. But that's what I've been doing for years. So there you got a little bit of my secret sauce. And so next up, I want to bring on Christina. She's going to share a little bit about her story about kind of pre-understanding these things. Here's a picture of Christina here. Then she's going to talk about how fueling has actually made a big difference to her. So I'm going to bring on Christina. Welcome, Christina.
Hang on. There we go.
All right. There you are. Yeah. So tell us just a little bit about that photo. Let me bring it up again here. And you can tell us just a little bit about kind of, you had a smile on your face and you have this cute little baby. But tell us about that.
I just had my daughter. She was born in, she's almost a year old, and that's a little weird, but when I was pregnant with her, I had gestational diabetes, and I probably had diabetes the whole time I was pregnant. I just didn't know until like almost the end of my pregnancy. I wasn't fueling my body properly. I was eating, I use the excuse, well, I'm pregnant and I can just eat whatever I want. And I gained 70 pounds with her. My highest weight was when I weighed in at the hospital, mind you, there was a baby in there. But I weighed 275.6. I will never, ever forget that number. It broke my heart that day. I just knew that something had to change because I didn't want to live with diabetes in my life. I just didn't need that.
Right.
So,
well, you look very different. We can see a snapshot of you because your audio was cutting out a little bit, but we see, you know, kind of your after picture or you now. And so I'm curious, like, what you've learned about fueling your body and how that's taken you from where you were to really where you are today. What is the total? Where are you at as far as how much weight have you lost? And what is that? What have you learned about that?
I've lost 91 and a half pounds. The half pounds really matters. I've lost 91 and a half pounds since I had my daughter. And part of that was a child, yes, and all those things that come with it. But the other part was that I learned with the help of a health coach and a community that fueling your body is the most important thing that you can do for yourself. And I'm having to buy new clothes all the time. My husband can't keep up with me. Just to be able to look at myself in the mirror and know that I'm not just doing something great for my daughter, Clara, but I'm also doing something great for myself. And the longevity of my life isn't just about the weight loss. It's about the mental health and being able to provide myself and be able to find that internal happiness and joy that I lost because I was drowning myself in not taking care of who I am and fueling my body properly.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Great stuff. Well, congratulations. You're an inspiration to many. I've known your story for a while, and it was just so important that people got to hear your story and to see that through through working with these four components that we're talking about, and obviously we're focusing in on the fueling your body properly, you're different. Like, I mean, you're different in your reflection. You're different in how your level of hope, you're inspiring other people. Lots of people in the chat window are just saying, hey, congratulations, awesome results. So I just want to thank you for sharing your story with us today and really for inspiring us to say, wait a minute, if Christina can do it, maybe I can do it, right?
Yeah. So thanks for coming on today. And it's really not, and it's really not as hard as it's made out to be. You just have to say yes to your goals and your life. I mean, really, just yes to who you want to be.
Yeah. Excellent. All right. Well, thank you so much for sharing with us today. And I'm sure we'll see you next time. So for those of you, we're going to move on into our next section here. So we've got Daniela and Nick Carulli, and they're going to be talking about one of the cornerstones, which is community. So welcome, Daniela and Nick.
Hi, guys.
Hi, really glad to be here with you today. Thank you for the invitation and the opportunity to share with you. So just as a little blip of background, my husband, Nick Carulli, is a physician, and we have a medical practice, and we have so loved engaging with patients differently and helping them dramatically make changes. And all the things that you've heard so far, Alex talking about habit and Craig talking about fueling, are foundations for building something amazing. And what we have really found is that there's still more to it than that. There's another piece to building something. If you've remodeled a house before, you might kind of have an idea of what building something includes. Maybe you've gone to Home Depot and collected some things, or maybe you asked for some advice and maybe you got some bad advice. Has that ever happened? So you might have gotten some bad advice and you went home and you tried it and it didn't work. And you go through this whole process and you find books and resources and ultimately, if you're fortunate, you find the right group of people to help you really get this organized and move forward. And that's what I really want to talk about today is when we're on a journey of ourselves, when we're trying to build our habits and we're trying to fuel our bodies, it's really tough to do it alone, right? I don't know about you, but I don't know the answers to everything. And Nick, you're a physician, and I know you know an awful lot, but do you know everything?
No. I'm not a surgeon.
You're not a surgeon. Yeah. And the other thing that I remember is back then, so when this picture is coming up, I hear, you know, this was us before, and I know I look at myself before, and you know, people used to tell me that I was thin before, but I knew that wasn't me. Is that gal in the orange shirt the gal that you married?
No.
And so I knew it wasn't me, and I wasn't entirely happy, and I struggled. But I'm going to tell you throughout the conversation today a little bit of magic that I found. And I want to share that with you so you can enjoy it as well. And Nick, when you first really decided you wanted to get patients healthy, was that something you knew how to do for them all by yourself?
No.
Okay. No. So you hear all this, we don't know what to do by ourselves. But when we're on a journey of health, and we're essentially remodeling ourselves, wouldn't you agree? We're remodeling ourselves, and often it's from the inside out. We're creating a better version of ourselves, and one that is powerful. But the cornerstone, one of the cornerstones of doing that is the habits that Alex talked about. Another one is the fueling. But then there's another hugely important piece, and we find this piece so vital, and that's community. That's who we hang out with. It's who we spend time with. And there's actually research on on how our community affects us and how the it's something like, you know, the top five people that we hang around with, we tend to be the most similar to. And so when we're trying to change or remodel ourselves, we don't necessarily want to get whole new friends, right? You don't want to say goodbye to your friends, but you do need to find a group of people to help you remodel and be a little different. And so when I started looking up, you know, well, what is community anyway? And I've heard the term common unity. We've used that in this group. But I looked it up in the dictionary, and it really had two definitions. And one was a group of people living in the same place, having particular characteristics in common. Okay, and that's pretty general. The second one is the one that I love. And that is a feeling of fellowship with others as a result of attitudes, interests, and goals that you have in common. And the reason I like that one is because that's where the power of movement is, right? It's the power of you and me linking up together and saying, we've got this. We're going to do this, right? That's how we've stayed together for 30 years, right? Mm-hmm. We've got this. We're linked up pretty well. So I'd like to share a little bit about something kind of hard in my life, actually, that has to do with community, because I'd like you to get a clear understanding of just how powerful that can be. So when I was born, I was born in Germany, and I was born into a fabulous family, had wonderful extended family in Germany. But I was there a brief period of time. I can remember the time vaguely because I was quite young, but I can remember being surrounded by love. You know how we tend to remember the feelings more, and that's what I remember. But we had to leave there when I was pretty young because my dad was, my mom was German, but my dad was military, and he got assigned to Vietnam. So we moved stateside so that we could access him in Hawaii when he would go on leave. And so we moved to California, which was near my dad's parents, who he did not have a strong relationship with, but he had hoped that they would watch out for us. Well, long story short, we were in a little apartment. My mom got terribly ill. And as a tiny young child of 3 years old, I remember darkness. That's what I remember. And I remember the fear because my mom was sick. Oh gosh, goodness, I didn't expect that. But I remember that, and no one came, right? And finally one day, there was banging on the door, and somebody got a key and came in. And I didn't know at the time even who it was, but it was my estranged grandfather. He had never really been in the picture or anything. And he had come back into town, heard from my grandmother that we were there, and was mortified that she hadn't checked on us. So long story short, I moved from that situation to moving across the United States when my dad came back from Vietnam and went back to Germany for a little while. We spent a year being transferred, one community to another community to another community. Probably hit 30 states in a year, okay? My second grade year, for example, I really didn't live anywhere and I really didn't go to school anywhere. We were moved so much. And the reason I share this with you is because if you can imagine trying to build something with the resources of two people, I had my mom and my dad, and they were great, and they did the very best they could, but they really had no great resources because we were being moved all the time, and neither did I. And so what we learned is we only trust each other, and we only work together because that's all we have. And that's pretty powerful, right? At least we had each other. That was awesome. But what I'd like to contrast with you a little bit is Nick's experience, because it's wildly different from mine. And I learned a lot from it. So Nick, can you share a little bit, just kind of a picture of how you grew up and what
sure.
that was like?
I grew up in an Italian family. So in Portland, there was a tight-knit community and there were a lot of Italians that lived there. And I grew up thinking that the whole city was my cousins. We'd have people come over all the time and introduced as, oh, these are cousin Joe, or this is cousin Kath, this is whoever. And so there was always people around the house. My mom and dad owned a restaurant in Portland for 50 years. And so I grew up around people. I mean, they'd take me to work with them. I'd sit in the coffee shop. I'd talk to the waitresses. I'd talk to the customers and go in the bar and get kicked out of there because I wasn't supposed to be in. But, you know, I grew up around people, which really, I think, shaped the way that I can do what I do now. Mom and dad, you know, mom worked a lot, dad worked a lot, but I had my brother and sister were home. My grandma lived right behind us. So if somebody didn't show up for a shift at work, my mom would have to leave and my grandma would take me and they'd come over to the house. And if grandma wasn't there, then one of my cousins would come over. And so I had a lot of people around me to work with or deal with if I needed anything. If I needed to be taken to school, even the neighbor next door would take me to school. It was sort of like I had this big extended family around me. And I think that really helped me learn that community is so important, and being there for other people is really important too. So the restaurant really probably shaped the way that I am now, just because I'm not afraid of people. I'm not afraid to talk to people. I'm not afraid to ask for help or, you know, help someone else, because that's just what we grew up doing.
Yeah, that's awesome. So the reason I wanted to share that is because if you're like me, coming into community is probably hard. And I don't know what your reasons would be. They could be far different from mine. But it took me a long time. I spent a long time watching and observing and even resisting, didn't I? Mm-hmm. I resisted community because it was unfamiliar to me. To me, it was you latched hands with a couple people and you didn't let go because that's all you had. And but what I realized was that while there wasn't perfection in community, what there was there was protection in numbers. And there was a strength and there were relationships that could support you through just about anything. There were resources that I had no idea about that could be found within other people. And they didn't even need to be experts, but just resources that I could grab onto. And so over the years, I can't even say that Nick was able to fully bring me into the sense of community. Truth of the matter is, this community that we're in right now, this health community that I engage in with regularly, kind of pulled me in because I wanted to restore my physical health at the time. I wanted to remodel my body. But what I realized is there was a lot more remodeling that needed to be done. There was a lot of personal growth that needed to take place. There was trust that needed to happen again. And as I've always loved people, I could love on them, but I sort of kept this this little shield up because my upbringing was, you didn't know who you could trust. I mean, I don't think that was intentional, but that was just the process. And you can imagine moving from community to community, my parents weren't going to say, oh, go home with the neighbor, right? They didn't even know who they were. So what I would like to encourage you to do is to grab onto community. And if it's hard, find a safe one. And I can assure you that this one is a safe one. There aren't many neighborhoods anymore like Nick's. I think you can probably vouch for that, mm-hmm. right? We've tried creating that and finding that for our children. And it's just hard because people move a lot more. So when you can find a community like this one that's stable, it really makes a difference. And wouldn't you say that our clients and our patients that engage with this community have a holding power with their health?
Oh, yeah.
And so that's what we've seen. So I'm just going to ask, you know, what if we immersed ourselves in health and the people around us were doing the same thing. Wouldn't that be easier? I know it is, because I know what my growth has been. And I would love to bring on Sherry. Sherry is somebody who's been absolutely amazing in terms of utilizing our community. And I've been able to watch tremendous things with her, but I would love you to hear her voice and what she has to say about community. Hi, Sherry. How are you today?
Hey, I'm doing great. Thank you, Daniela.
Awesome. So thank you for being here. Sherry, up here on the screen, the beautiful lady in the blue, tell me a little bit about her and how she was feeling at that time.
That was a really tough time. I was feeling fat and frumpy and just riddled with pain and had really bad chronic pain and just was sitting in some chronic bad place and chronic pain and a lot of unhappy days and just not doing very well at all. Just feeling really frumpy.
Okay, yeah. I remember you saying that it was hard to get things done that you really wanted to get done, huh?
Yes, hard to get things done, hard to even get a sentence out. I was really breathy. I couldn't talk very well, couldn't even walk and keep up with anything, couldn't get from point A to point B without being winded.
Yeah, wow. Okay, so there's another you in black there. Tell me about her.
Yeah, she's very light now. She's down to 130 pounds, lost that 30 pounds, and just feeling much happier, much more healthy, and just really ready to go and ready to kick into spring and get in to go and get her life back and get her goals set for a nice 40th reunion this summer and getting her life back together and getting off all these pain medications and getting everything kicked back into gear and having a great life and enjoying this healthy eating.
I love it. So I heard you mention that you've eliminated an awful lot of your pain medications, haven't you?
Yes, I have.
Wow.
I'm able to cut out a lot of the inflammation from getting off the Pop-Tart and coffee and breakfast that I was on and the unhealthy eating plan that I was not eating well and not sleeping at all and not drinking any water, and that was setting me up for a lifetime of inflammation. And that was really a key that the 5-in-1 brought me into eating well and getting into that fueling process.
Awesome, Sherry. So can you tell me, we've been talking about community. You've heard my story now that I don't think you ever knew, but
no.
But tell me a little bit, you and I were talking earlier about what this community has done for you. Can you share a little bit about that?
It's been a great community. It's really helped me with being, my husband works the graveyard shift, so I'm alone a lot. So the community really helps me engage and keeping in contact with keeping my goals cemented and keeping my keeping me grounded and keeping my inspiration up and keeping my me grounded and keeping my accountability and to the challenges. It keeps me inspired to get it up and get going in the day and just gives me great ideas of keeping the time to keep my fuelings going. It gets great ideas on just everything in life, and there's just so much I could tell you about the little things that it gives you, but you get such great ideas for each little thing you could do.
I love it. So what I heard is really kind of two things that you mentioned in specific was you found some inspiration and you found that inspiration. Where do you think that came from?
The inspiration comes from everybody else's stories and from getting the great ideas from the different talks and the different subjects, from the healthy habits and the different huddles that we listen to and the different challenges that come up, the health habits of health challenges and the habit meltdown challenges. We get so much different insight of how everyone works, and then the camaraderie that comes around with that, and just the support that you get from other people.
Awesome. And the second thing you mentioned was goals, that you learned something about goals. Tell me a little bit about the value of that in your life.
Oh, it's helped me so much to set goals and to write them down and to be able to look back and say, wow, I really did get that win in there, and to learn about how to set goals and to learn to strive to make it not just a goal on a scale, but to seek out new goals for a new perspective on life and new something to set for and something to strive for and get new ideas for just new things to get out and
awesome.
Do.
That's great. And you know, one thing that I don't think you mentioned here today, or maybe I didn't catch it, but man, it struck a chord with me. When we were talking before, you said something to the effect of it's real. Do you remember when you said that? Tell me what that meant to you.
I said that it's real because it just really comes down to the people are really sure, share their stories from their hearts, and they really come and they really try to help you, and they really care about everybody, and that it's not just fake and phony stuff. They really care about each other, and they really care about your feelings, and even on the challenges on the wall, they really care about how each other's doing, and they really come together and share our feelings and our...
I love that, Sherry.
And it's just really nice to have that camaraderie and that help. It's not just your coach that's there for you for every time you need something and have a question. You have that extra camaraderie that comes into play every time you play on a challenge.
I love that, Sherry. Oh my goodness, because what you're talking about is something the world doesn't see so much anymore, and that's real relationships and big talk rather than little fake relationships and small talk, right?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for sharing with us, Sherry. I love your story.
Thank you so much for having me.
Wow, thank you, Nick and Daniela and Sherry, just for sharing all about community. And you know, community seems like it's a wonderful thing when you have it, and it's a terrible thing when you don't. And so I appreciate what you guys had to share. We're going to move on to our last cornerstone today. We've got Bill Ritchie, and he's going to be sharing with us about the value of coaching, the value of having a coach in your life. So welcome, Bill Ritchie.
Yo, am I on there okay? Okay. You know, one of the questions that I suppose a person has is, what in the world does coaching have to do with health? One word, everything. One word, everything. You know, the first thing that you want to know is that, watch out. You don't want to look at that very long. That was me, 56 pounds and 14 weeks. It took me 6 years ago. And I'm pleased to say that I was exactly at my goal weight this morning. So that's what you call sustainable change. But at any rate, the first thing that I think is really important is that we have been built for relationship. That is the first thing. We have been built for relationship. There's nothing more basic than that. However you want to go back in history, now I happen to have been a pastor, so I have a particular understanding of that, but however you want to go back in history, what you find is we have been built to relate with other people. In fact, it's fair to say that we crave relationship. That's why you don't want to be left out when you're a little kid in school, or you're the last one picked, or some other such thing. Just like these little kids here, you want to be a part of a gang of kids, other people. Speaking of gangs, that's why some younger people end up in gangs. They aren't drawn there so they can take drugs or sell them or shoot people or who knows what. They're drawn because it is a place where they are accepted. because that's deep craving within that we all want relationship. And that's why the second thing is important here, and that is coaching is all about relationship. You know, if you look at this slide, no doubt most of you will recognize Michael Phelps, the most medaled swimmer in all of Olympic history, an unbelievable, almost freak of nature. And that coach who is beside him is a guy who has been coaching him since he was a kid. And in this case, that coach is really, in a sense, two things for Phelps. He's a coach and he's a mentor. Now, those are two very different things. There are really three things that you might think about: coaches, mentors, and counselors. If you think about counselors, they are people who are highly skilled, highly trained, and they are able to help us process things in life that we just aren't able to get at on our own. I mean, most everybody could use somebody to process with them at some point. In fact, I stopped calling counselors counselors. I started calling them processors. Love it. Love what they do. The other type of a person is a mentor. Now, a mentor, usually mentors, it's not super formal, goes over a long, long period of time. It addresses very specific needs with insights of somebody who has been way down the road. I had a mentor who I was with and met regularly with for 12 years. And we never set up anything formal. Nobody ever used the word mentor, but that's in fact what it was. And it was one of the greatest blessings in my life. A coach, on the other hand, is usually for a set duration, like a basketball coach is going to coach during the basketball season or whatever the case happens to be. It's usually a set duration. It's a bit more short term. Coaches are really good at help people bringing what is within them to play, just like Phelps's coach did. He was, or Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan's coach said about him when he got him, he realized this kid has unbelievable raw material, and all I really am here to do is help shape that. And so with a coach. But in the midst of that is relationship. So that coaching is all about relationship. Now, here's what's important. The third thing is that coaching is the key to sustainable change in health. Coaching is the absolute key to that. next one, Craig. It's the key to health because here you have it. It's all about relationship. You're never going to create change that lasts, sustainable change, by knowing stuff. I mean, figure it out. I did my first diet when I was 11. And since that time, I've done more than I could begin to count. And I read all the books. I read all Barry Sears' books on the zone. And I read Atkins' books on the Atkins program. I knew the stuff. Big deal, right? Knowledge isn't going to do it for you. Intimidation, and we've all been there, guilt, shame, all that kind of stuff, that is never going to move you forward and keep moving you forward. And neither is pressure from the outside. You better get that weight off or else, you know, that kind of stuff. It's just not going to work. Inside, we got to have the want to, intrinsically motivated. See, here's the deal. People who try to get healthy on their own, especially in a weight loss phase of getting healthy, is people who try to do it on their own fail. In over 85% of the cases, actually it's higher than that, people who do a diet, regain all their weight, become unsuccessful after a little over a year. And, you know, they start with great hopes and so forth, and then it just falls apart. There are reasons for that. For one thing, diet is spelled die, D-I-E, with a T, and who wants to do that? For another thing, for most of us, dieting means restricting, means starvation, means stay away from that. And when you're doing it alone, trying to get healthy alone, you're white-knuckling it. It's all on your own willpower. We all run out of that stuff way, way, way too fast. We've only got a limited amount. And more than that, we don't know what the heck we're doing. You know, when I did all these different diets, if you would have said to me, Bill, what'd you lose? I would have said, well, weight. And they'd say, yeah, I know, but what did you lose? And I'd say, well, 20 pounds. And then they would say, 20 pounds of what? And I'd say, I don't have a clue. Because, of course, I didn't. And when you're trying to do that alone, it's kind of, oh, well, nobody knows anyway, and what the heck. And so you just kind of quit. The fact is, this week in the newspaper, an article came out that said that even though Americans are heavier than they have ever been, less of them are inclined to get healthier. Think about that. Heavier and less inclined to get healthier. Well, what that means is the healthcare crisis is going to just go astronomically because you've got metabolic syndrome with diabetes and all the stuff that goes with that. Are you beginning to see the importance of relationship here? See, coaching is the key to sustainable change. Why is that? Because coaching is all about relationship. All about relationship. It opens the door of hope for us. You know, we say on our own, I've tried to do this. I think I can. No, I can't. And a coach comes along and says, Bill, I know you've tried this a bunch of times, and I feel so bad that you've had this experience, but I tell you what, we can do this. Not you can do this. We can do this. Let me take your hand here. We're going to do this. And suddenly I'm thinking to myself within, well, hey, wait a minute. Maybe there is hope. And that's what happens. That relationship opens a door of hope. And it gives a glimmer of help going forward. And there's an offer of somebody to journey with me. I'm not doing this alone. Who in the world likes to take a hike just totally alone? When you're with somebody else, it's so much more fun. I mean, when you see that spectacular view and go, whoa, and nobody is there to share it, it's not nearly as much fun because we love to journey together. Why is that? Because we're built for relationship. And so when we have a coach helping us in our health journey, it brings us somebody to journey with us who can point us to resources along the way, because we all have these little snags, these little challenges saying, well, now, wait a minute, I've got a birthday party coming up. Well, how do I do this? Well, how do I do that? And a coach can help, you know, Google, get us to the resources that will help us sort of move forward. So the fifth thing I would say is, you can try to get healthy on your own, but my question is, why would you do that? You will be vastly more successful with a coach along the way. And by the way, people who coach, and I would have to say this for myself, I haven't been a health coach for 6 years, but people who coach have a 5 times greater chance of keeping their weight off. Why is that? Because they're in a community of health, ongoing, they've locked into those relationships. A whole lot of people are moving forward together, encouraging each other, cheering each other on, and they're helping other people along the way, which does nothing but build them up. I mean, it's just, it's a win, win, win. Everybody wins. So, what does coaching have to do with getting healthy? One word, everything. Absolutely everything. I want to introduce you to somebody who is a new friend. Nikki Zimmerman is her name, and she is an incredible person. I see her walking around. It looks like she's getting healthy right there. You'll see the before picture of Nikki. Nikki's not a person who has 150 pounds to lose. But she had a stubborn amount of weight that she just wanted to take off. And Nikki, tell me a little bit about that picture on the left, the sort of Nikki that said, okay, that's it.
Can you guys hear me?
We can.
All righty. Well, I definitely didn't feel very good about myself. And again, I have 30 pounds to get down to my ideal weight, and it is, like Bill said, 30 stubborn pounds. I can probably count in my bathroom right now, let's see, wraps and teas and anything you can imagine to help me lose it. But in fact, it just helped me gain a few more. So it did not help. You often wouldn't see me without a sweatshirt on. I just didn't feel comfortable in my own skin. Even though I wasn't really told that by anybody, my husband, for 20 years now married, is very supportive and loves me just the way I am, but it comes down to me loving myself and the way I look. Wow. And how I feel. So, I have two adult children, 21 here next week and 20 coming up in July. I work for a trucking company for 16 years. And if anybody knows anything about trucking companies, they have donuts and candy everywhere. And they celebrate every month for our birthdays with a cake from Costco.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So, and I was always the first one in there to get my piece and maybe even a second.
Well, you know, Nikki, the thing that's so exciting is now Nikki is new to getting this whole issue dealt with to move forward to create sustainable change. And she's down 13 pounds in 4 weeks. And that is exciting. Betty and I rejoice over that. What, Nikki, what are you learning about the value of coaching as we're moving through this?
Oh, I am learning so much. I am learning that it's okay to, the feelings help. It's okay to eat as much as I am every day. It's just what I'm eating. And I'm being held, I wouldn't say accountable, because Betty is very understanding and she listens and coaches. And you, Bill, coach me very well. And I'm a little nervous. just the encouragement I get from both of you. Like I said, I honestly, now Bill, you know, I've contacted you months and months ago, but then I kind of was scared and I was contemplating on just ordering it online with no coach accessibility for myself, but I am so glad that I didn't, because I know once again it would have been something that I know I would have failed at. That's why I contacted you guys.
Well, and we would have missed out on this relationship, and that would have been the worst part of all. Hey, can you give us one tip about coaching that people might find helpful?
Oh, one tip. How can I pick one, I guess? It's even hard. The encouragement that they give you is great. Yeah. And that's what a lot of people need to hear.
Is great. You are absolutely right. And that's kind of the heart of everything. We encourage each other in life. I mean,
exactly.
When we talk to you, Nikki, we are encouraged ourselves. Because when you are excited, we are excited. And, you know, your wins are our wins. We get to celebrate together. And how cool is that?
Exactly. Remember,
we're built for relationship. And so everybody wins. Thank you, Nikki.
Thank you.
Wow, great stuff. Thanks, Bill. Thanks, Nikki. Thanks, everybody that's shared today and for the stories of inspiration. And as we're kind of closing up here, I want to move on and kind of wrap things up and get back to where the place we were at when we started. You know, we talked about these different aspects of these four different cornerstones, and these cornerstones are covering coaching, our habits, our community, and how we fuel our bodies. And so all of those combined together are what we build these habits on. And those lead into the capstone. And so at this point, what I wanted to do is actually jump over and have give you guys an opportunity to ask some questions. I'm sure you have some questions that are out there. So on your Zoom window, you have a little button that says Q&A. And you're welcome to, we've got some people that are standing by that can answer your questions if you do have some. Maybe you Maybe you want to know how to get in touch with someone that's a coach, how to learn more about the fueling, how to learn more about building those habits, maybe about community, right? Or simply, you know, having someone there, like Nikki said, having that encouragement there can be the difference between success or a do-over, continual, endless do-overs. And so I'm super excited to share that with you. Anybody have any questions so far? Daniela and Nick just said the acronym TEAM, and TEAM stands for Together, Everyone Achieves More. And I completely and absolutely agree with that. So great stuff, guys. So I'm going to jump over here. Where do we go from here? What's next, if you will? And or now what? So you've heard some things. Maybe you were inspired by one of these stories, and maybe you've said, you know what, I'm tired of being living life on the couch, watching from the sidelines. I want to get back involved. I want to start getting back to when times were good. Think about a time in your life when you were as healthy as you can remember. It was just that sweet spot in your life. And think back, when was that? Was that when you were in high school? Was it out of high school? Was it when you got married? When was that time? And what would it look like if you could take some of those components and revisit those, maybe reestablish those in your life as something that's really powerful for you? And so here's what, we can help. There's a number of people. You probably are invited by someone that has some investment, some skills, some tools where we can help you. I've been, everybody that's spoken today, all of our four main speakers are health coaches, and we work with people every day on helping them to say, what if you could get back to that place? So we can help you. So here's what you need to do. These three things, real simple. Connect with the person that invited you to this webinar. Schedule a time to meet with them. What we're going to do when we schedule a time is I take people, all of us, we take people through what we call it's kind of a health interview or a well-being assessment. We basically just kind of look at your life right now in current reality. And then we sort of fast forward into the future, and we say, if this is a scale of 1 to 10, maybe this area of your life is a 3. What would it look like if that was an 8? What would be present in your life? And so we take you through this an interview, and we figure out where you are and where you'd like to be. And then you basically get to make a choice. You say, when do I want to start feeling better? You know, when I've asked myself that particular question, when would I like to start feeling better? I never say 2 weeks from now. I never say, maybe next year. Especially I'm a little bit sick right now. And how soon would I like to start feeling better? Right now, right? And so connect with the person that invited you, schedule a time to go through a little interview, and then make a choice when you want to start, when you want to do that. So last up here, we've got another health talks that's scheduled. So today, if you heard something from one of our speakers or one of the people that were sharing their stories that inspired you, I would say, think about coming again. Think about inviting them to join you next time. Our next health talks is going to be on June 3rd. And we're going to be doing a hybrid the next time we do this. So we're going to have a bunch of people that are meeting in person at a location. And we're going to stream this on the internet as well. But what if you didn't live in I live in Vancouver, Washington, most of us do. But what if you lived somewhere else in the country, but you got some people together, build some community, and you tuned into this webinar at your house, maybe invited some friends over. And afterwards, you made some connections. You talked about what could be better. What would it look like? So think about that. But it's June 3rd. You got a little bit of time between now and the next one. But I really want to encourage you, within I would say do it right now. If this inspired you in some way, send a message to the person that invited you and say, thanks for the invitation. Let's talk. Let's talk about how things might look if they were better. And just want to really encourage you with that. I want to give one more opportunity for folks to throw in maybe a chat. If you had something, a story that inspired you or something that stood out, if you had a question, we'd be happy to answer that at this point. But if not, I think at this point here, we're going to send you on to enjoy your Saturday. And so I want to thank Alex. I know he's probably going down some awesome ride right now with his hands in the air and having a ball with his family. Thank you also to Nick and Daniela Carulli for what they brought, speaking about community and how people have different experiences with community. But when we do connect over something that we care about, we are stronger. And then I want to also thank you for Bill, as you talked about the value of having a coach, someone there that's been down that road before you, that can put a hand out and say, hey, take a left here, take a right here, right? And we're built for a relationship. We're built for a community, and we thrive there. And I think sometimes we struggle to survive without it. So thank you all for what you brought today. Hope this inspired you. Hope something inside of you has awakened today. And we're looking to have more yes days in our future than we have in our past. So have a good day. Enjoy. It's April Fool's Day. So enjoy April 1st, and we'll see you guys next time. Take care, everybody.